So, ich begrüße Sie alle sehr herzlich zum heutigen Abend. Ich freue mich, dass wir einen so prominenten Sprecher haben, der auch den Wettbewerb mit der Europameisterschaft und anderen Ereignissen durchaus bestehen kann. I would like to continue now in English. I said it's a nice, we have such a nice evening, and you are not only looking at the audience competing successfully to the weather outside and to the many cafes where people could sit outdoors, but there is also a very important a play in the European Soccer Championship tonight, where basically every Austrian watches, but not these people here. So congratulations to your to the attraction which you bring. So with these words, I would like to officially welcome Professor David Gross, our today's speaker. Welcome, David. I welcome his charming wife, Jacqueline Savani. I welcome Tom Hentzinger, the president of IST Austria. Welcome, Tom. I should mention that this is the first joint lecture of the Austrian Academy of Sciences and the IST Austria, the first joint ÖAW Austria lecture. The idea was born spontaneously in one of our meetings about half a year or so ago, and we decided to do this on a regular basis. We have to see whether we do it every semester or every year, but it's more important to do this on a regular lecture, and we are happy to have such a great kickoff for a new lecture series. So we are really happy about this. I would like to, for the benefit of our guests, but also for the benefit of those of you who are here for the first time, I do my traditional part of explaining a little bit where you are. We talked about it a little already. We talked about it because, as you might know, the Austrian Academy of Sciences owns a very beautiful collection of old maps and Sammlung Woldan. And I found out that our guests have a fancy in old maps, so we show them some of the maps today. This is evidently the main building of the Austrian Academy of Sciences. It was built around 1750 under Empress Maria Theresia as the central building of the university at that time. And you can see that from when you look up on the roof, you see the allegories of the four classic faculties, kind of super departments of the old university. Where you look back now, David, this is the medical faculty, where you actually see the dissection of a body going on. You see pieces of the body sticking out from under the table and so on. It's very realistic. Okay, to the right of me here is the faculty of theology, Catholic theology of that time. There was only Catholic theology, and to the right of you is the faculty of law, which is which actually is called the science, scientia, the science of the lawful and unlawful things. And behind me is the faculty of philosophy, which contains all the humanities of today and the natural sciences and so on. And you see actually two telescopes up there. So it really showed what these people were doing at that time. It might also be just maybe two or three more remarks. One remark is there was a big fight when this was built. Who gets the long sides and who gets the short sides? And you saw the lawyers and the theologians won at that time. Another remark, the university was very much under the control of the Jesuits until then, and Maria Theresia created a new organization where two faculties were not under the control of the Jesuits anymore, and this was the Faculty of Medicine, which basically was responsible for a very famous medical school which started in Vienna at that time, and the Faculty of Law, because she wanted to build a new efficient administration for the empire, and she succeeded. So just one more small remark. In 1848, we had a revolution here in Austria, which again, like all others in Europe, was not successful. But the first big assembly of that revolution, of the students, happened in here, in this room. Can you imagine a revolution starting in such a room? The effect was that the students were not allowed to enter the building anymore, and the building was given to the academy. So this is a small side effect. This was just my short brief introduction, and I would like now to ask Tom Hensinger to say a few words. As I said, IST Austria is the co-organizer of today's lecture. Please, Tom.
Yeah, thank you, Anton. So the Austrian Academy of Sciences and the Institute of Science and Technology Austria, I think, are without doubt the most important non-university research organizations in Austria. And the obviously big difference is the Academy looks back at hundreds of years of history. IST Austria is just about 7 years old, at least the campus. The Academy is also a lot broader. We already heard it includes humanities and social sciences, while IST Austria focuses on the natural sciences. Yet from the very beginning, there has been a very strong kinship between the two organizations. And I should just here really point out and also thank Anton. He was actually the one who had the very first idea of something like IST Austria about 12 years ago, and it's thanks to his lobbying to politics that actually IST Austria ever had happened. And now, in these 7 years since our campus opened, we've grown to 40 research groups, and actually 8 of our group leaders, of our professors now, are either members of the Academy or of the Junge Kurie, the sub-academy for young scientists. And so I hope this connection will grow even stronger over time, and I'm very happy and also grateful that we can organize this joint lecture series, and especially that we have such a great first speaker today. And I'm very much looking forward to the talk. Anton will do the introduction.
Introduce our speaker today, Professor David Gross. Professor Gross started, and you might correct me afterwards if I say something wrong, at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, mathematics and physics, then a PhD at Berkeley followed with Geoff Chen, working on S-matrix theory. Afterwards, junior fellowship at Harvard, a visit to CERN in Switzerland. 1969, he started a career with, the usual letters, at Princeton University. And since 1996, he is at the Kavli Institute of Theoretical Physics in Santa Barbara, whose director he is now, if this is correct, the Kavli Institute of Theoretical Physics. I should mention that he had some very famous students. I mentioned two names, Ed Witten and Frank Wilczek, were among your students. among the awards, it's clear, it's evident, the most important, the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2004, together with Frank Wilczek and David Politzer. Then to mention a few others, the Grand Medaille d'Or of the Académie des Sciences in Paris, the Harvey Prize of the Technion in Israel, the Dirac Medal, the J.J. Sakurai Prize, and many others. His memberships include certainly the National Academy of Sciences of the United States, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the American Philosophical Society, which is a society where you only become a member if you are elected. It's not just a society where everybody can join. And interestingly, a member of the honorary fellowship, or member, I don't know how this is officially called, of the Indian Academy of Sciences, and a foreign member of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. This is completely incomplete, but it's just my small excerpt of what I found. So without much further ado, David, I would like now to ask you to start with your lecture, please.
More or less correct. Thank you for that introduction and for inviting us, both of us, to this, to this beautiful city, and for being such gracious hosts. I must say, this is perhaps the most beautiful hall that I have lectured in, and it's going to be hard to keep my thoughts on the frontiers of fundamental physics when faced with a medical dissection, the laws of God, the laws of man, but behind me I have philosophy and science. So I'm going to talk about some of the frontiers of fundamental physics. I apologize for not having the time or the expertise to talk about all the frontiers of fundamental physics, and there are many. I will, of course, concentrate on that area in which I mostly worked, which is sometimes called elementary particle physics, sometimes called high-energy physics, sometimes also called fundamental physics, since the goal has been to explore and discover and understand the basic building blocks of matter and the forces that act on those elementary constituents of matter, which we call sometimes elementary particles. Now, the study of the basic structure of matter and understanding how they fit together, how they interact, has been going on for thousands of years. The birth of elementary particle physics, however, is more recent. I date it back to Ernest Rutherford. The first elementary particle, of course, was discovered some years before by J.J. Thomson, the electron, and studied in some detail. But it was Rutherford who understood that in order to understand the structure of atoms and what goes on inside atoms, which were, even in 1911, much too small to be seen or manipulated or probed directly, he needed or invented the method of bombarding small objects with energetic beams of small objects and seeing what would happen. And in his laboratory, he had he and his postdoc and his undergraduate student, Geiger and Marsden, did the following experiment, where they bombarded gold atoms with alpha particles, the nuclei of helium atoms, that Rutherford was one of the first explorers of radioactivity. That's what he won his Nobel Prize for in chemistry. And he bombarded the gold foil, gold atoms, with energetic alpha particles, and his students and postdoc, after sitting in a dark room for hours until their eyes were extremely sensitive, detected the deflected alpha particles on a fluorescent screen and measured how many came out at different angles. As you know, the experiment surprisingly showed that many of the alpha particles came right back at large angles, which convinced Rutherford that the atom, that the positive charge and most of the mass of the atom must be localized in a very small region in the center of the atom. Now, you know, this discovery that was made of the nucleus, 1911, Rutherford, who clearly thought up the experiment and understood its implications, his name does not appear on the experimental paper, because Marsden and Geiger were the ones who actually did the experiment. But right after their discovery paper, his theoretical paper of analyzing the implications of this pattern of deflection using Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism, and the deduction that the atom is composed of a small, less than 1/100th the size of the atom nucleus, which contains all the positive charge and most of the mass. The discovery of the nucleus was this theoretical achievement of Rutherford. And particle physics began at that point and proceeded for the next 105 years in analyzing what goes on inside the nucleus. Today, of course, we have much bigger ways, accelerators that accelerate protons or other particles. In the case of the Large Hadron Collider pictured here, protons to enormously high energies in order to probe shorter distances within the nucleus. And instead of Marsden and Geiger detecting with their eyes the scintillations on a fluorescent screen, we have these massive detectors here, the ATLAS detector at CERN. But the method, the basic experimental technique, is exactly the same. In order to discover what goes on inside subatomic particles that you can't directly probe or manipulate, you smash these particles together and see what comes out. This is sometimes described as how you might go about understanding how a Swiss watch works. You would take two watches and smash them together, and boom, and then take a picture right after the collision. Analyze the picture carefully to try to deduce what are the components of the watch and how does it work. Now, for watches, this is not a great method. There are better techniques you can imagine. But for elementary particles, in the last 100 years, we haven't come up with a better conceptual idea of how to probe matter at the nanometer scale that we're now probing. And we continue to smash particles together, see what comes out. Of course, as I said, we use much bigger accelerators. We need to construct massive accelerators to achieve high energies and energetic collisions. And since those collisions produce massive numbers of particles, we need massive detectors, like the ATLAS detector, to which is here. These are toroidal magnets that bend the particles that emerge in the magnetic field so that we can measure their momentum. And the collision events are very complicated. This is one of the first events seen at the LHC 6 years ago. And my experimental colleagues have to, with their incredible ingenuity and with the aid of the very precise theories that we have, analyze such photographs and try to deduce what the watch is made out of and how it works. But this 100-year-old, 105-year-old field has produced remarkable results. In fact, it has produced a remarkably successful theory of matter and force. We have understood what the atom is made out of. In fact, right after, 2 years after Rutherford's discovery of the nucleus, the similarity with the solar system led to a model of the atom, which had to employ quantum mechanics in a semi-classical way, the Bohr atom, and that stimulated the development only 10 years later or so of quantum mechanics. So the theory of atoms and molecules and most of macroscopic physics was well understood shortly after Rutherford, but it took the rest of the 20th century to understand that the nucleus was made of nucleons, protons and neutrons, which in turn were made of quarks. And these are essentially, these particles and their cousins, the electron and the quarks, and the other families of quarks and neutrinos and heavier electrons, are, as far as we can tell, with maybe the Higgs and other particles we have indirectly seen, one or two other particles, all the constituents of matter we need to explain the observable world. Even more importantly, we have understood in a very deep way the forces, the three forces that act on these elementary constituents, electromagnetism, of course, and the two forces that act within the nucleus, within the proton, within the neutron, that hold the quarks together, the strong nuclear force that turn one quark into another, give rise to radioactivity, the weak nuclear force. All of this has been put together just about now 40 years ago, or a little more, in what we call the standard model. The standard model is an amazingly successful mathematical description of just about, in principle, in a reductionist sense, all observations that have ever been carried out with unprecedented scope. That's why I don't like the name the standard model. There's an interesting history why it got that name. Certainly should be called the standard theory. It is a theory. In fact, the most successful mathematical theory we've had of nature ever. And it is a theory because I can put the equations, or at least the Lagrangian from which the equations come from, on one t-shirt. And using the techniques relativistic quantum physics, or quantum field theory, in principle, we know no reason why this set of equations following from this Lagrangian would not explain every experiment that we carry out today or could carry out, with some few exceptions. So this is an incredible achievement. And it, to reiterate, consists of a list of the elementary constituents of matter, the quarks, the light up and down quarks that make up the neutron and proton, the nuclei of atoms that we're made out of, the electron which surrounds it in a quantum cloud, and its accompanying neutrino. And then two other families of heavier, unstable quarks and leptons, which follow exactly the same pattern as these more familiar ones, but are heavier. These are the constituents of matter, and we are, at the moment, totally unable to calculate their properties in the sense of, you know, what their mass is and how they mix quantum mechanically. The standard model does not explain that, and those have to be measured as they have been and used as parameters in this theory. What we understand in great detail, however, are the forces that act on these quarks, which are electrically charged and strongly charged and weakly charged. The remarkable feature of this standard theory is that the basic nature of the forces that act within the atom and within the nucleus, and even gravity, are basically fundamental underlying level, the same kind of force. And the one thing I'll try to explain that's a little technical is how that works in the case of electromagnetism and the strong nuclear force. There's one other element that has gotten quite a bit of noise the last few years, which is another sector called the Higgs sector that must be added to the standard theory to truly understand the features of the weak nuclear force that render it different than electromagnetism or the strong force. So this is the elements of the standard model, a measured list, observed list of elementary constituents. We have good evidence that there aren't more families of quarks and leptons. This is it. And a deep understanding of the forces that act within the atom and the nucleus, plus the Higgs. This theory, with its 19 or so parameters, 19 sounds like a lot. In most cases, one or two are enough. In some cases, almost no parameters. I'll say a word about that. Works in a sense from the smallest distance imaginable where we can control the laws of physics, the Planck scale that Max Planck identified using the fundamental dimensionful parameters in nature, the speed of light, Newton's constant measures the strength of gravity, and Planck's constant that Planck discovered that defines a length and time and mass scale. And as far as we can see, the standard model is a consistent description of physics until you get to such extremely small distances. And we know directly from observation and calculation and theory and experiment that this standard model works everywhere in the universe, to the edge of the universe. So the range that is encompassed by this theory of matter and force is unprecedented, at least, you know, in a strong reductionist sense. Now, I want to try to explain why the force of electromagnetism that we're all familiar with can be, in essence, the same as the force, the nuclear force that holds quarks together permanently inside protons and neutrons and appears so different at a macroscopic level. So an electromagnetism, as you all know, is a theory of charged particles. You have the electron, for example, and if you place next to it a particle of opposite charge, like the anti-electron predicted by quantum mechanics plus relativity, particle of equal mass but opposite charge to the electron, the two will attract each other. They will set up an electromagnetic field. These field lines describe the force that acts on a charged particle, and that electromagnetic field pervades space, transmits the force from charged particle to charged particle. The force, as you know, falls off like the inverse square of the distance between the particles. That's a brief summary of electromagnetism. Now, there's an easy way, which we teach our students to calculate, to derive that inverse square law. We use Gauss's law, which tells us that if we surround a region with a sphere and measure the flux of the electric field through the sphere, so that is roughly the magnitude of the electric field. If I surround this charge with a sphere of radius r, the electric field times the area of the sphere is equal to the total charge contained within that sphere. Gauss's law, therefore, leads to the fact that the electric field, and thereby the electric force, is inversely proportional to the distance from the charge. And consequently, if you try to pull the charges apart, you have to do work to overcome this force. But since the force falls off like 1 over r squared, the energy it takes to separate those charges, is finite and saturates when you pull the charges to infinity. You have to simply do an amount of work equal to the ionization energy. So because positive and electric charges interact with an inverse square law, you can pull electrons out of the atom, make them run in wires, do work, and give rise to the Industrial Revolution. Now, what I want to tell you is that the force between quarks, which is the origin of the existence of the proton and of nuclear forces, of nuclear energy, and of hydrogen bombs, is exactly the same kind of force. The theory that of that what we developed to understand the properties of quarks says that quarks also have a charge. They actually have three charges, not just one like electrons. They have three charges. And they're colloquially called colors. So the charge of the quark has three varieties, red, white, and blue. The colors are just labels for the three kinds of charges one can have. And if I put a quark here, say the up quark, up and down refers not to the strong charge, it's another label, the red quark. And here I put the anti-red quark, which has an anti-red color. The force between them at the classical level would be exactly the same as electromagnetism. They would set up a field, which we call the chromodynamic field. Instead of the electric one charge, we have three charges, the chromodynamic field. And naively, classically, the force between them would be inverse square law. We could pull the quarks apart. We could pull quarks out of the proton and make them transport them in quark wires and have a whole quark industrial revolution. But that, of course, we can't do. And nobody has ever pulled a quark out of a proton or seen a quark, which is why it took so long to understand that quarks actually existed and were the constituents of protons. If they were, people said, well, you would produce them by smashing protons together. The quarks would come out. You could ionize the proton, and yet you couldn't. So where does the difference come from if the underlying theory is, as it is, of the quark-quark interactions just the same, in essence, as electromagnetism? The secret is quantum mechanics and the quantum properties of the vacuum. Now, you might think the vacuum isn't very interesting, but in quantum mechanics, it is. In a quantum mechanical system, the vacuum is not a quiet, quiescent place. As we already learned from the beginning of quantum mechanics, nothing in quantum mechanics is quiet and quiescent. A classical oscillator can be at rest in its ground state. It's simply at rest here with no motion. It, of course, can oscillate if you pump in energy, but in the ground state, it's at rest. Quantum oscillator can't be at rest, of course, as Heisenberg explained, the essence of quantum mechanics is that if you were to try to observe the ground state of the oscillator by sending in a light ray, a photon, you would set photons come with quantized packets of energy, which can't be reduced to zero with a given frequency, and you set the oscillator into what we call a zero-point oscillation. The vacuum, which contains no particles and no fields, that's a classical picture. Were you to observe, or try to observe the vacuum, as we in effect do in these high energy collisions, the properties of the quantum vacuum, you set the fields into, which are consist of many oscillators, into motion. And because you can create particles and antiparticles with enough energy, you create pairs of those as well. The quantum vacuum at the relevant scale, where the forces are strong, is a complicated medium. So the strong force is mediated by the chromodynamic field, much like the electric force is mediated by the electromagnetic field. But that field doesn't live in a classical vacuum. It lives in a quantum vacuum. And this is a picture, a simulation of the chromodynamic fields that are fluctuating within the vacuum at the scale size of the proton. So the proton is about this big. So this is a few proton lengths across. So this is 10 to the minus 13 centimeters. Now, if you could observe, and we do in these experiments, what the quantum vacuum looks like, this is the picture. This complicated medium, complicated quantum vacuum, these fields are not trivial. These are the chromodynamic fields. The chromodynamic fields, unlike the electromagnetic fields themselves, are charged, carry color as well. So the dynamics of this chromodynamic field are quite complicated. And it is not obvious what happens to the force that's transmitted by the fields in this medium. Just like a fluid or a solid-state medium affects the force between electrons, the quantum vacuum affects the force between the quarks. And what we discovered, in effect, was that in this kind of theory, the effect is to squeeze the electric field line, the chromodynamic field lines, the flux lines, to a tube. This is very analogous. In fact, there's a deep duality between this phenomena and what happens to magnetic field lines within superconductors. Those of you who know about the Meissner effect, this is the electric version of that magnetic Meissner effect. And it gives rise to two phenomena. One, the quarks, when brought together, actually feel a weaker and weaker force. It's called asymptotic freedom. But when you try to separate them, the force does not decrease with distance. And that, again, is a consequence of Gauss's law, the same physics that underlies electromagnetism. Now, since the flux is confined to a tube, when you do a fixed area, the Gauss's law tells you that the electric field times this fixed area, not an area that grows as you separate the quarks, is equal to the total color charge. The field remains constant, the force you have to overcome remains constant, and the energy now trying to separate the quarks increases linearly. So it would take an infinite amount of energy to truly separate the quarks. And that is called confinement. So that's asymptotic freedom. This is actually also a simulation in QCD of the flux tube that's formed when you pull quarks apart. These arrows here represent the chromodynamic field lines, and the flux you see is confined to this fat tube, which means that you can't separate the quarks. Which explains why no one has ever seen a quark. What happens in the real world when you smash protons together with a trillion electron volts? You have enough energy to create just about anything, particles which weigh 100 billion electron volts. But you can't produce quarks. Quarks by themselves would have an infinite energy. What happens in the real world is that this string breaks. You have enough energy in the collision. You give the energy to the quarks, they fly apart, and then a quark-antiquark pair materializes out of the vacuum. That'll happen with some probability, and this string or flux tube will break into two flux tubes, each being a pair of quark-antiquark, which will have no net color. The strong force, the strong nuclear force, is the strongest force of all of them. And yet you've never felt it. And you've never felt it because the atoms you're made out of, the nucleons you're made out of, have no color. The only remnant in the nucleus of the strong force is a kind of van der Waals force between one nucleon, which is neutral, and another, which is neutral. And you feel a molecular force, just like between neutral atoms. That's the strong nuclear force. But it's very short range and only acts within the nucleus. But it explains why this nuclear fission and fusion is so powerful compared to electromagnetic, molecular, or atomic forces. Okay. This fact that the force between quarks d decreases as you go to shorter and shorter distance, or becomes stronger as you go to larger distances, is now beautifully confirmed by experiment. These different points here represent many different kinds of experiments, all governed by this comprehensive theory. And it works now at predicting the behavior of the what we now regard as the background to the interesting events that occur in these collisions at the Large Hadron Collider over 12, 13 orders of magnitude. But for a theorist like me, the most satisfying part of having a theory of the proton and a theory of the nuclear force is being able to calculate with almost no adjustable parameters the masses of the fundamental particles that make up nuclei of atoms, in a sense, to be able to calculate your mass. Now, as far as calculating your mass goes, essentially we can do that with no adjustable parameters. Now, it's a bit of a cheat, but it's more essentially true. First of all, your mass comes, of course, from the mass of the protons and neutrons that make up the nuclei of your atoms. Electrons contribute almost nothing. Second of all, your mass does not come from the mass of the quarks that make up the proton and neutron. The quarks weigh less than about a tenth of a percent of the mass of the proton. If the quarks were massless, it wouldn't change very much, a few percent. So most of the mass of the proton comes from what? It comes from the kinetic energy of the quarks that are moving around inside the proton. They can't get too far because of asymptotic freedom. The force, the energy it costs to separate them increases linearly. So they fly apart, they're like tied together by these flux tubes, which are like strings. They get to some distance, they can't go any farther, they come back. They're rattling around inside the proton, mostly roughly with the speed of light, back and forth. That's a lot of kinetic energy in a confined region. The size of that region is determined by when the coupling becomes strong enough. And the coupling, the strength gets bigger and bigger, the force between them. So not most of the mass of the proton arises from the confined energy of, there's also the force fields, the glue that holds them together of the in the chromodynamic field, and the kinetic energy of the quarks. There are no parameters. And therefore, your mass is confined energy, and it is calculable with good precision without any adjustable parameters. To be precise, to calculate to the level that people doing numerical calculations in QCD do today, of the spectrum of, here's the proton here, and of all these other nuclear particles, the pion, the kaon, the rho, these are particles made out of charmed quarks. You have to include in addition the observed small corrections coming from the masses of these light quarks, or in this case heavy quarks, and you can now calculate the masses of all these particles with essentially no parameters to less than a percent. Okay, that's the successful theory of matter and force that we have. But the frontiers are beyond what we understand. And there are experimental reasons that inform us that this cannot be the last word on matter or force. There is dark matter that astronomers have discovered, matter throughout the universe, most of the matter in the universe. We're not sure what it is. It interacts with the stuff we're made with very weakly. Neutrinos have a mass. The standard model needs to be slightly modified to accommodate that. We're not totally sure that how that works yet. We would like to understand the baryon asymmetry that's observed in nature and the cosmic acceleration. There are theoretical drivers to extend our understanding beyond the standard model, the unification of the forces, the strange hierarchy of scales, the masses and mixings of the quarks and leptons, which we cannot calculate within the standard model, and so on. And I want to describe a few of these open, burning questions that shape the field. One is the search for unification. Unification has been a very successful strategy of fundamental physics. Newton unified the motion of apples and planets with a universal theory of gravity. Everything is attracted by gravity, and you could explain the motion of apples and planets using the same equations. Maxwell unified the phenomena of magnetism and electricity, which at first sight seemed so different. When the standard model was completed, we had a bunch of forces that act within the atom and nucleus, and a bunch of particles, quarks. Quarks feel all the forces. Electrons and neutrinos feel only the electromagnetic and weak forces. So these are like five pieces of a jigsaw puzzle, and if you're given five pieces of a puzzle, you try to fit them together, and sometimes you discover that the piece is missing. They don't fit to form a complete picture. The remarkable thing about the standard theory as it emerged in the middle 1970s was that these five pieces fit together very beautifully, as if all of these forces, these three forces, which I argue to explain a bit, are really fundamentally the same kind of theory of a field that permeates space and is created by conserved charges, like electromagnetism. All of these theories are the same kind of theory, in essence. They differ because of the properties of the vacuum. In the case of the strong force, the quantum properties of the vacuum alone. In the case of the weak nuclear force, you have to add this extra Higgs-ish particle and its interactions to change the large distance behavior of the weak field. But they fit together very nicely, as do the matter content of nature. The quarks and leptons together fit together as if the force can be unified to a single force with 10 charges, or 5 charges, depending on which variant you like, or more. The simplest being a theory of particles, each of which has 5 or 10 kinds of charge. a unified force law and a unified form of matter that contains all the colored up quarks and down quarks and electrons and neutrinos, and even in this case with 10 charges and extra companion of the neutrino which provides its mass. The obvious problems with such a unification as to why these forces look so different at the scale of atoms and nuclei is answered by saying that, well, they look the same if you look at very short distances, but macroscopically, the phenomena, But at larger distances, because of the complicated structure of the vacuum, the symmetry that underlies this unified description is broken spontaneously, and that accounts for the differences that we observe at nano-nanometer scales between these forces. They can also have different strengths because when they, after the symmetry breaking, we saw, or I told you, in the case of the strong nuclear force, the force changes as you change the distance between the charged particles. So although the forces are very different at the atomic scale, if you probe those forces at very short distances, they might be the same. This idea was strengthened by taking the standard theory and extrapolating the forces way beyond where we can measure today, which is about a TeV of energy in these collisions, which corresponds to a distance of 10 to the minus 17 centimeters, to distances which are shorter, require more energetic, higher frequency microscopes, accelerators. And remarkably, these three forces, and even gravity, seem to come together or have equal strength at a very high energy, very short distance scale. This was understood 40 years ago, and for many of us has been a very important clue that the unification of all the forces that we've identified within the atom, within the nucleus, together with gravity, which at ordinary distances, atomic distances, nuclear distances, still a very weak force, unless you put a lot of particles together to form a planet or a star, should, you know, is being suggested by this extrapolation. We extrapolate our present theories, all the forces seem to come together. They're all of the same nature, at least the non-gravitational ones are. And the strength comes together at very short distances. But this could be a coincidence. And the fact that they come together doesn't tell us particularly what might happen at this scale of energies. Now, there have been many ideas over the last 40 years as to whether there's any interesting physics in between. And one of the ideas that has intrigued many of us and is still open, and there's still no direct experimental evidence for, is something called supersymmetry, which is a conjectured, speculative new symmetry of space and time. We're all familiar with the symmetries of space and time, like rotational symmetry. So you know that the laws of physics are unchanged if you rotate your laboratory. If you do an experiment, you measure how long it takes for this to fall, and you rotate your laboratory and do the experiment, you get the same answer. Those symmetries are fundamental properties of space-time. And they're very important. Otherwise, you would have to, if you didn't have the symmetry, you would have to report in which direction your laboratory was pointing when you did an experiment. But you don't have to, because the laws of physics don't change when you rotate your laboratory. The laws of physics don't change when you translate in space your laboratory. So you don't have to write in your paper that you did the experiment in Vienna, as compared to doing it in Santa Barbara. The laws of physics are the same. Translations in space, or translations in time. So these fundamental symmetries of space and time are essential for organizing the laws of physics and seeing coherence in the pattern of events in the world. Supersymmetry is simply the statement that the laws of physics are invariant also under rotations in superspace. But what is superspace? So superspace is adding to ordinary space a new and strange and quantum dimension. So imagine you have another dimension in addition to that direction, and that direction, that direction. But you measure displacements or translations in that direction with anti-commuting numbers, which obey, which are sort of quantum. They don't commute. The theta 1 times theta 2 is minus theta 2 times theta 1. There, you can invent such numbers. Mathematicians invent all sorts of numbers, like the square root of minus 1. These numbers are simpler than imaginary numbers. And there's a beautiful generalization of physics. All the physical theories that we know of, actually, can be generalized to a description of physical reality where events occur in superspace. And are labeled, fields are labeled not just by points in space and time, but by points in superspace with anti-commuting coordinates. This possibility was discovered by physicists doing string theory, but no matter, there's a generalization of everything we know in physics to a super world with superspace and invariance under super rotations, where you can rotate a super dimension into an ordinary dimension. That's a possibility. Interesting mathematical physics. More interesting is the fact that supersymmetric generalizations of known physics, like the standard theory, can explain some of the mysteries we seek to understand, like the hierarchy of scales in nature, the unification of the forces, and perhaps the existence of dark matter. For example, this unification of the forces, here I plot the inverse of the strength of the force, 1 over alpha, alpha being like the fine structure constant. This is the force of electricity. The inverse of the force decreases linearly on a logarithmic scale according to the standard theory. This is asymptotic freedom. The strong force is getting weaker as we go. So the inverse is getting bigger as we go to higher energy, shorter distance. Today, we know enough experimentally, careful measurements, theoretically, careful calculations to extrapolate, and these three straight lines don't meet at a point. Three straight lines need not meet at a point. But if you just supersymmetrize the standard model and say that at a TeV, a trillion electron volts or so, supersymmetry sets in, you no longer see the breaking of the symmetries that separates the breaking of supersymmetry, then these forces meet at a point after being extrapolated over 11 or 12 orders of magnitude. That requires that supersymmetry be visible at around a TV, and some of us, again, regard that as an important clue for supersymmetry to be visible at a trillion electron volts. That's a lot of new particles, because in supersymmetry, when you rotate in superspace, you transform a particle like an electron that we see all the time to a super partner, like, which is called a selectron, which nobody's ever seen. And so for every particle that has ever been seen, supersymmetry would predict that there's a super partner which has never been seen so far. And unification or a coincidence. The field of fundamental physics is very different than the field of, say, condensed matter physics, where theorists have the great luxury of waiting for experimentalists to discover a new phenomena and then trying to explain it. Here, we have very few clues as to what is going on at the next threshold of fundamental physics, where the basic laws of physics that we have today will break down in some way. And so we have to take such clues very seriously, as many of us do, or ignore them. And the final important clue is perhaps the most important, because it's based on observation, the observation of astronomers that there must be missing matter that's not visible in every galaxy and in clusters of galaxies that causes the stars to rotate as fast as they do. And so they picture, say, the Milky Way as a small bunch of protons and electrons, and in the center of a much larger halo of dark matter that's only indirectly visible through its gravitational effects. And by now, their highly precise quantitative models of the universe require that most of the matter in the universe be of this dark matter variety. Most likely what they call WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles. We don't know. Nobody has observed these particles directly. If they are WIMPs, then every second, a few hundred of them are passing through you at 500 kilometers a second. Now, luckily for you, they don't interact very strongly, and therefore you don't get cancer immediately. Unfortunately for us, they don't interact very strongly, so we can't detect them. They're like neutrinos. They can pass through the Earth and not being deflected once by a collision with our nuclei. So we hunt for them in underground laboratories with very sensitive detectors, looking for a rare collision of a WIMP with a nucleus that would give a signal that's distinguishable from the background, and that's not easy. Those experiments haven't yet detected WIMPs. We look for their annihilation in the sky to produce radiation, characteristic radiation, that we might see, and we try to produce them in the laboratory at the Large Hadron Collider. With enough energy, you can create any particle and its antiparticle. But the neat thing is that just about any supersymmetric version of the standard theory predicts a candidate for dark matter. And there's the remarkable fact that if the masses of those new superparticles were around a TV, a trillion electron volts, 1,000 times heavier than the proton, then in the Big Bang successful description of the evolution of the universe, you could calculate how much dark matter there would be, and it comes out roughly in the right ballpark, which again is an important clue for supersymmetry that might appear at energies accessible by the LHC, or a coincidence. So this is the nature of the challenge for elementary particle physics. For theorists, we have the standard theory is so successful that we have almost no indications of where the theory must break down, and it must, to be replaced by a more comprehensive, more unified, better theory in order to answer some of those theoretical issues. But we have a few clues, and supersymmetry is one of the most important possibilities, and with the clues that I've indicated. And we're looking for something like this to occur at the LHC. This is a typical SUSY event, supersymmetric particle being produced, or dark matter candidate for that matter. This is a collision occurring here. The beams are going into the screen. They meet here, collision. Lots of particles go out in this jet of particles. Lots of particles go out this way. You can see that something is wrong. Newton's third law is violated. You know, there's a lot of momentum going this way, not that much going this way. And if you add up all the momentum, assume that momentum is conserved, you find that something is missing. Something is going out, which is carrying energy and momentum. This is a way of observing something which is invisible. That's how neutrinos are observed. This missing energy can then be studied, its properties, its decays, and identify that perhaps as dark matter, that perhaps is one of the new particles predicted by supersymmetry. But anyway, I want you to remember in the next few years, maybe, well, probably not this year, but, and probably never, and maybe never, that scientists at CERN will announce in a press conference that they've discovered supersymmetry. If that happens, what they're really discovering are quantum dimensions of space-time. Now, I want to say a word about space-time, but I remind you that space and time are not something we directly detect or measure. They're a model of physical reality that each of us constructed during the first years of our life, while our brains were developing. We constructed a model of events occurring in a three-dimensional manifold and time. Quite a remarkable achievement. I think probably the greatest intellectual achievement that any of us ever achieve is in our first few months when we developed this model of space and time. But we've had to modify it a lot over the last century with Einstein's special and general theory of relativity. And it's perfectly possible that discoveries at the LHC will force us to realize that that model is incomplete and that we actually live in superspace, or physical reality is described by a space generalization of space-time, which includes quantum dimensions. Now, the future of, I think I will skip my discussion of the future of experimental particle physics, so I'm running out of time, but and go on to more theoretical discussion, which has to do with what might happen here upon unification. The most important clue in my mind that we have as to how these subatomic and atomic forces unify is the fact that this happens at the point where the force of gravity becomes a strong force. People who sometimes are surprised by the fact that gravity is such a weak force, since it's the force that we feel all the time. And we usually, luckily, don't feel the other forces of nature, especially the electromagnetic force. It's dangerous to feel the electromagnetic force. The other forces are all forces that act on charges, and they pull opposite charges together, and they form neutral objects. That's why we don't feel the electric force most of the time. We certainly don't feel the nuclear force. It's pulled together to form neutral nuclei, and it acts then only at very short ranges. But the force of gravity we all feel, because it's universal. Everything attracts gravitationally, and there is no opposite charge. The charge of gravity is mass or energy, and all particles have positive energy. So that's why we feel it. We can't shield it. There's no anti-gravity. We don't feel the force of gravity between individuals, but the Earth, which has 10 to the 55 atoms, that we feel, because all of those atoms are pulling on you. Within the atom, the force of gravity between the proton and the electron is 40 orders of magnitude weaker than the electromagnetic force. So the force of gravity fundamentally is an incredibly weak force. But the charge of gravity is mass or energy, so that if the proton and electron have relative energies, which are 20 orders of magnitude greater, so you have a collider that accelerates them, so their energy is 10 to the 20 times their rest mass, then the force is the same magnitude as the other forces of nature. So at this scale of energy or distance, the scale that Max Planck identified as the fundamental scale of distance and energy dictated by the constants of nature, gravity is equal in magnitude or similar to the other forces of nature, which suggests that, again, all of these forces are unified. So the search for unification has largely proceeded over the last decades in an attempt to unify all the forces of nature, including gravity. And that is one of the great accomplishments, qualitatively, of string theory, which remarkably started out as a phenomenological theory of the nuclear force. These fat flux tubes between quarks, you know, a quark and anti-quark connected by a string is not a bad description. And so theorists trying to understand the nuclear interaction, the properties of what turned out we understood shortly after to be quarks, were led to a theory of strings. And today we understand that these are really the same way of describing the same physics. The kinds of physics that underlie the standard model and theories of open strings with charges at the end are simply different dual descriptions of the same physics. But even more remarkably, developing this theory of extended objects, people were led to realize that open strings can be closed. You can tie the ends together. For consistency, you must. And that closed strings describe gravity. So in an attempt to understand nucleons, nuclear particles, because of this flux tube behavior, people develop string theory, which automatically contained gravity, unified all of these kinds of forces into a consistent framework. For many years, this possibility of describing all the particles we observe, not just the nuclear particles, but the leptons and all the particles, including the quanta of gravity and the other forces as different vibrations of a single extended object, has been one of the goals of the string theory approach to fundamental physics. And once again, it raised a lot of new questions about the nature of space and time, our most fundamental concept. One question was, are there extraordinary dimensions, not super dimensions, but ordinary dimensions? String theory suggested that there might be. And in the simplest versions of string theory, with six extra dimensions, in order to avoid the obvious contradiction with observation that you don't see six extra dimensions, one looked for solutions of the equations that govern string theory, which are generalizations of Einstein's equations that determine the dynamics of space and time, in which some of the dimensions are curled up into curved manifolds that solve these generalizations of Einstein's equations. And there are lots of such solutions. In the beginning there was one, and now there are zillions, in which at each point in space, in our picture of space, there is an extra six-dimensional compact curled up manifold. And the remarkable thing about this approach is, in string theory, that the questions that the standard theory is unable to answer, like why are there forces that we observe with one charge, two charges, three charges, why is there electromagnetism, weak, strong nuclear force, why does matter come in these groups of quarks and leptons, and what are their masses? In a particular stringy approach, using the compactification of six dimensions, these questions are answered in a novel way. They're determined by geometry, by the shape and curvature of the hidden dimensions. I think Plato would have loved this. Geometry determines the structure of matter and force. Well, what is the situation now from my theoretical, speculative point of view about the framework we have for discussing physical reality, the basic structure of the fundamental laws of physics? The standard theory is based on relativistic quantum mechanics. Faraday, Maxwell, Einstein, you know, quantum field theory, it's based on relativistic quantum mechanics, or what's called quantum field theory. 40 years ago, we set out to try a different approach based on what used to be called string theory. Meantime, we've learned that these are actually the same thing. It's not too surprising, because these flux tubes of quarks are very much like strings, and the physics of those standard model flux tubes and the physics of strings turns out, and this is now established with enormous the rigor of physicists, not of mathematicians, but of physicists, beyond doubt, in simplified cases, to be different ways of describing the same thing. String theory is not really a theory, but an extension of quantum field theory, which is not a theory either, it's a framework. It's an enormous framework, contains within it the standard theory. Standard theory is a particular quantum field theory. But the framework of fundamental physics that is so well-tested and successful in the standard theory contains, we now understand, much, much more. It contains descriptions that, not just in terms of elementary particles, but extended objects, strings, or higher dimensional objects, and as far as we can tell, all consistent field theories are included in that framework, together with quantum gravity. This framework can give us dual descriptions of dynamical quantum space-time, that's quantum gravity, in terms of a generalization of Einstein's general relativity string theory, or ordinary quantum mechanics or quantum field theory, and these are simply dual ways of describing the same phenomena. This very new way of looking at the fundamental framework of relativistic quantum mechanics is still in under development. There's no final story here. We have no idea what the boundaries of this framework are, and there are some profound open questions that this raises. First, once again, the nature of space and time. When one uses the string way of looking at the dynamics of quantum space-time, most of the classical notions of space-time that we developed as infants, that we live in a smooth manifold, that the topology of space doesn't change, that we live in a fixed number of dimensions, 1, 2, 3, no more, go away. You can, in the stringy version of things, continuously tear space-time, change the topology, and even continuously go from a description with one number of dimensions to a description with fewer or more dimensions. In fact, most, me and many others, working in this field, believe that space-time is probably best thought of as an emergent concept. That in the fundamental formulation of physics will not be in terms of events taking place in space-time, fields that depend on space-time, particles or strings moving in space-time, but rather space-time will emerge as a good way of describing things in the large or over large timescales. Well, gravity and space-time would be emergent concepts. That's one of the suggestions that this new way of looking at the framework brings forth. But the other question that remains paramount is, in such a framework, successful framework, what picks out the particular dynamics, the particular theory? What picks out the standard model from all the possible quantum field theories one could write down? This is perhaps not unrelated to another question that we're forced to answer or confront, which is, what picks out the initial or final state of the universe? So a word about that. The universe is something, again, in the 100 years we've been, that I, you know, working, the last 100 years, has evolved from almost no knowledge of the universe, just pricks of light in the sky, to a rather comprehensive understanding of the stars that make up the visible universe and their history for the last 13.7 billion years, and evidence of accelerated expansion into the future. But a big question mark as to how it all began, one that can't really be avoided now. The astrophysicists and cosmologists who have been so successful in understanding the cosmic microwave background they see when light decoupled from ionized plasma, to understand that they have to have fluctuations, quantum fluctuations, early on in the period where they believe the universe was rapidly expanding. They have to go back here. And from a theoretical point of view, we can't avoid to ask the question how the universe began or what the initial condition was. This was because Einstein taught us that the universe is the dynamics of space-time, the universe is the history of space-time. And if we have the goal of fundamental physics is to construct a solution to the dynamics of all the forces of nature, including space-time itself, then it will have to address the question as to what happened at the beginning, the boundary, and perhaps the end equally. In other words, if you are trying to understand a theory that includes the dynamics of space-time, then you can't avoid this question. Physics has always been able to avoid worrying about the initial condition. But now that's become a central question. And here we have a situation in physics that has happened before where we don't even know what the rules of the game are. We have to address questions we haven't had to address before, and we don't know what the rules are. So we have a remarkably successful theory of elementary particles, but undoubtedly the most exciting questions are being raised and remain to be answered. We have fantastic instruments and experiments and speculations. And I did promise, although I've clearly run way over time, to address the question as to how long this can go on. So when I was interviewed by the press yesterday, they asked me, is there a final theory? And are you going to construct it one day? And I told them I would address that question here. Is there a final theory? Can we find it? We might be too dumb. Or we might lose the will to proceed. So whether there's a final theory, I regard as a geometrical question again, but the geometry of knowledge. Now, what I mean by that is a geometrical model of knowledge and ignorance. There is a popular model of scientific exploration, which I don't like, called the onion model. You know, nature is an onion and you peel it away layer by layer and the truth lies at the core of the onion. And this picture brings tears to my eyes. It doesn't explain anything. So I have the opposite point of view. Knowledge is a domain, a sphere within a sea of ignorance. And we're pushing outward, and not going inward, but outward into the sea of ignorance. And this, from this model, you can explain a fact that we're all well aware of, namely that as knowledge increases, and your sphere of knowledge grows, and as a species, we gain more and more knowledge, and most of it's in the libraries, but it's accessible. So does ignorance, because the ignorance that we are aware of only lies at the frontiers of this sphere of knowledge. Ignorance out here, far away from what we know, is like, as Rumsfeld once said, these are the unknowable unknowns. The only ignorance that we're aware of is the knowable unknowns at the boundary of knowledge and ignorance. So as knowledge increases, so does ignorance, because the surface gets bigger. And this is a phenomenon we're all aware of. The more we learn about nature, the more we realize we don't know. But fortunately, the volume increases faster than the surface, so we're wiser as a species. So I've just shown you a geometrical model of knowledge and ignorance, which explains something that is clearly true. We keep getting more and more ignorant as we get more and more knowledgeable. But now we can use this model to address the question as to whether there could be a final theory. Because in the terms of this model, the question is there a finite amount of ignorance? If you had a final theory, you'd run out of ignorance. And today we saw some beautiful maps of the world downstairs. And this is a earlier map, medieval times of the Earth as it was known to Europeans. This is the known Earth, the sphere of knowledge. This is the unknown Earth. And this is the boundary. And with the exploration of the Earth, one extended the knowledge systematically outward. There were societies of explorers, but the Earth, of course, turned out to be... So if the Earth had been flat, as some thought, this would have gone on forever. One would have had the ability to explore the surface of the Earth for infinite time. But of course, the Earth is round and compact, and sooner or later, one ran out of ignorance, or one ran out of territory to explore. And we now have, perhaps at a scale of a kilometer or less, a final map of the Earth. And explorer societies have shut down. There's a final map of the Earth. So is the sea of ignorance of physical reality compact? Is the sea of ignorance unbounded and infinite, a flat Earth? And in that case, there's no final theory. Ignorance keeps growing as knowledge grows. Or is it compact like the surface of the Earth and finite? I'm agnostic. It could be either way. I see no way of deciding. However, it's clear that we see no horizon so far. There's no sign of curvature in the world, nature as we observe it. There's no indication that we're running out of good questions. Quite the opposite, they multiply. Even if we did, this wouldn't, of course, be the end of physics, because most of physics is not pursuing this reductionist goal that conceivably could end, although there's no sign of it. Most of physics explores the infinite structures that can be built from these microscopic components. But there's another danger, of course, that we might be too dumb to proceed. Why should we, as a young species on Earth, you know, we're maybe a few million years old, but really only special to Homo sapiens, a few hundred or 200,000 years old, why should we believe that we, at this point in the history of the universe, have reached the pinnacle where we can understand the final theory or superspace or, you know, the initial condition of the universe. We certainly are aware of the fact that our fellow species on Earth don't have that ability. I've been unable to explain the Schrödinger equation to my dog. And we know that a dog cannot comprehend the Schrödinger equation. We understand, we feel that. It's very hard, however, for us to imagine that there are concepts or descriptions of physical reality that we can't understand, but why should we assume that we somehow are the ultimate end of evolution? Well, if you think this way, you can get depressed, but I think there are some reasons to be optimistic. First, there's the fact that language and mathematics is the highest form of language, has infinite capacity. Chomsky once said that a newborn child has the inherent ability to learn language just by listening to its parents, and then can utter a sentence that no one has ever uttered before. Language has that infinite capacity. Mathematics certainly does. So it's nice to have a tool to study nature which is not finite but infinite. Maybe it's not infinite enough. But from an experimental point of view, again, there is no sign that we are faced with questions that cannot be answered. How do we know? Maybe we're like the dog. Well, I think there would be a clue if we were nearing the limit of our capabilities. It would take graduate students longer and longer to get to the frontiers of knowledge. They would have to absorb all of these difficult concepts that have been developed over hundreds of years. They would start getting PhDs at 30, at 40, at 50. It would asymptotically approach infinity. There's no sign of that. As far as I can tell, young people get to the frontiers of knowledge as quickly as they ever did. And finally, you know, even if we were like dogs, we have the ability to start speeding up evolution and changing ourselves and coupling ourselves to machines. So I'm not worried about our inability to go on for at least a very long time. More dangerous is the loss of will and means to go on, especially in fundamental physics, elementary particle physics, astrophysics, cosmology, where society might simply tell us that it's too expensive or too difficult. And here, again, who knows? I can just express my hope and the admonition of David Hilbert, who famously, it's on his grave here, right? We must know, we will know. Thank you.